Welcome to Holy Impact Ministries Bible Study Night. God bless you. I'm Pastor Scott Velain with HolyImpactMinistries.com. And this evening we will be taking a look at Acts chapter 19. God bless you and thank you again. For those of you who were with us earlier, we had a little bit of a problem with our internet, and the internet had gone down on us. Apparently they are doing some work in the area. And it's the first time in at least the last year and a half that we've had that problem. But we were live, had people in the chat room, everything was going well, and all of a sudden the internet just decided it wasn't going to work for us. So we decided that we would go ahead and pre-record this particular lesson. So we're back at it again, pre-recording this, because we have a very important study that I'd like to do this coming Saturday on the seventh day Sabbath of Yahovah, 9 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. For those of you who don't know, we always gather together, and we have a live broadcast at 9 a.m. Eastern Standard Time on the seventh day Sabbath. And we have a study coming up called Willful and Intentional Sin. Is it forgiven according to Scripture? And that is an extremely powerful study, and I wanted to make sure that we got that out this coming Seventh-day Sabbath. And so I thought we'd better probably pre-record this Wednesday night Bible study, because I didn't want us to fall behind in our Bible studies in the book of Acts. So again, my apologies for not being able to be live and have the chat room and everything for this particular study, but I did want to get this study out to you. It as well is very important, and I want us to know and understand that as well. Today's study, again, Acts chapter 19, we entitled it Separations, Magic Cloths, and Demons. And I think you're going to find this study very interesting as well. We're going to give you something to take to your prayer closet, to bow your head, to bend your knee, to face the holy promised land of Jerusalem, and to pray in the name of Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, and ask if these things be true or not. Again, our discernment does not come from any man, priest, pastor, bishop, or pope. It comes only from the Ruach HaKodesh of God, and that's where we turn for our discernment. So, with all of that being said, let's go ahead, and we're just going to jump right into Acts chapter 19 so that we can go ahead and get this study out, and because it is just as important as the study coming up this seventh-day Sabbath. Again, for those of you who have never visited us before, at Holy Impact Ministries, we always have a Wednesday night Bible study, Wednesday nights at 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, and we do those live. We also have a chat room on YouTube, and we also have a better, more powerful chat room that's coming up that will be embedded in our website very soon, Speaking of websites, let me take you over to the website very quickly. This is our website at holyimpactministries.com, and this is where you can find us at. Again, if you'd like to join us for our Seventh-day Sabbath, all you have to do is click on the Seventh-day Sabbath tab. It'll take you right there. Also, with our Wednesday night Bible studies on Wednesday night, 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, you can click there, and they are embedded in the website. All you have to do is click there, and it'll take you right here to the Seventh-day Sabbath or the Bible Studies page. This is the particular Bible Studies page here, and then you can click on that, and then it'll give it to you now. Another thing that we always do at holyimpactministries.com is we always try to provide a PDF for you so that you have a written format of what we're talking about here so that you can cut, copy, and paste these Bible studies into your own Bible studies. Inform them for your own home fellowship or your own home church as well, which is what we highly advocate here at Holy Impact Ministries versus our brick-and-mortar churches that we know are falling away even as we speak. So again, home Bible studies and home churches are extremely important, and as time marches on, they will become more important. And we need to start those, and we need to get those up and running, and we need to do it right now. And we need to, if we do not start one, become part of one and become part of that fellowship and begin to turn back and learn what is written in the scriptures versus what today's modern day version of Christian academia is trying to teach us. So, very important. Everything we do at Holy Impact Ministries, our videos are free to download, and our PDFs are free to download. Everything that we do is free. We do not charge. We do not sell the Word of God at holyimpactministries.com. So, that is all there for you, and we want you to have those things. Again, just download them. You can cut them, copy them, paste them. Keep a hard copy if you can, and print them out and just keep them with you. And again, these are just things that you can take to your prayer closet. And again, test through the fire of prayer. So, with all of that being said, let me get back to Acts chapter 19, and we're going to get into Acts chapter 19 right away. So, last week, as we ventured into the beginning of the book of Acts chapter 19, we took our time and we talked about the gift of tongues. And we walked through the scripture and we talked about what the scripture had to say concerning the gift of tongues and how it is commanded to be used in the church and outside of the church according to not any denominational charter of men, not any philosophy or think tank or any early church fathers, but according to the scripture. What did the scripture say? And that's what we walked through last week. And we saw how Paul tells us very clearly that tongues, the gift of tongues, is to be used in the church and is not to be used in the church. So once again, I say these things were commanded because Paul clearly tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 37 through 40, that what he's just told us in his letter to the church at Corinth concerning the doctrine of tongues is not his own interpretation, nor is it his own opinion. But rather, Paul says very clearly that what he has told us in the book of Corinthians concerning tongues, and I quote, is a commandment of the Lord. And so I want to just go back and I want to revisit that scripture for just a moment, if we could, so that we can just understand the ramifications of believing in or falling for another man-made doctrine concerning the gift of tongues. Once again, let's turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verses 37 through 40. Let me just take you back over to the website here. We'll get that out of the way, and we'll drop this down, and we'll get into what we're talking about here today. Now, here it is, 1 Corinthians. Now, this is the end of chapter 14, and Paul has pretty much just gotten done enlightening us about the gift of tongues. And he's pretty much at the end of what he was trying to tell us. And what does he say here? He says, if anyone thinks that he is a prophet or spiritual, he should acknowledge that the things I'm writing to you are a commandment of the Lord. Do we see that? I want us to see that. Okay? If anyone does not recognize this, he is not recognized. So, my brothers, earnestly desire to prophesy, Paul says. And once again, we've been through this, we went through this last week. Which one of the two gifts was higher? Which one was more important, according to the Apostle Paul? Was it the gift of prophecy, or was it the gift of tongues? Again, it was not tongues. It was indeed the gift of prophecy. This gift is a gift that is high and far above the gift of tongues, according to the Apostle Paul. And even though we know through reading the instructions from Paul, who says that it is the Ruach HaKodesh, the Holy Spirit, who gives these gifts individually to those who he sees fit. So in other words, not all people speak in tongues, and you do not have to be speaking in tongues in order to prove that you have the Ruach HaKodesh of God, my friends. This is very important for us to understand. If I say nothing else about this, I want us to understand this. Even though it is not something that we must absolutely have to enter the gates of heaven, Paul says, do not forbid speaking in tongues, because again, it is one of the gifts that the Spirit gives. And we clearly see in the early church, in the book of Acts, we see Paul laying his hands on people, and not all, but some do have the gift of tongues as evidence of speaking in tongues. So, now, not all, again, now it doesn't say that all people have it, and I know that a lot of people will say, well, they don't say it every time because they already said it earlier, and they shouldn't have to say it every time. Well, maybe that's true, maybe it's not, but the fact is that no one can prove that every single person that the apostles ever laid their hands on always spoke in tongues, nor can they prove that every single Christian today must speak in tongues in order to get it through the gates of heaven, as so many different denominational charters of men try to teach us today. This, my friends, is simply not warranted anywhere in the Scripture, and I want to be clear about this. Nowhere by any apostle, nowhere by any prophet, nowhere by any high priest, nowhere by the Son of God, Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Messiah, nowhere by the Father are we commanded to speak in tongues. It's not in there, and you can't find it. And the reason you can't find it, my friends, is because it's not in there. And I want us to be very clear and very distinct about these things. And as we've said many times here at Holy Impact Ministries, my friends, it is just as important to know what is not in the Scriptures as it is to know what is in the Scriptures, my friends. And again, we have 5,000 different denominational charters of men out there, all teaching 5,000 different denominations and different doctrines of men. And we know that there is only one Jesus, there is only one gospel, and there is only one truth. So that means that 4,499 of them are wrong. So I want us to comprehend this, and I want us to ponder this, and I want us to understand and know this, my friends. Out of 5,000 different denominational doctrines, all claiming to be Christianity, 4,499 of them are wrong, because only one can be true. And we attest to the fact that the only one that is true is the one that is found in the Scriptures and the Scriptures alone, not dictated by any charter of men, any philosophical think tank, any early church fathers, or anyone else. And this is important for us to understand. So again, I just want to make this very clear before we move on and we move into the other part of Acts chapter 19. Again, Paul says, if anybody thinks he's a prophet or spiritual, he should acknowledge that the things that I'm writing to you about the gift of tongues here today, he says, are a commandment of the Lord. So we really need to go back and we really need to think what we've been programmed to think by this man and this woman and that woman. And we need to go back, read the Scriptures for ourselves and understand that those things that this man and that woman are saying are not commandments of the Lord. What Paul says is a commandment of the Lord, found only in the Scripture. And that's important for us to understand. And again, he says, if anybody doesn't recognize this, then they're not recognized. It's just that simple. So he says, my brothers, earnestly, he says, desire to prophesy, because this is the better gift. He says, don't forbid speaking in tongues, because that's a gift too. So don't forbid it. as long as, and we've seen this in his writings already, as long as there is an interpreter. If there is not, then Paul tells us very, very clearly that those who are in the church are to be silent. Silent. Not screaming, not hollering, not shouting, not wailing, not interrupting the message coming from the pastor. None of that kind of stuff, my friends. It tells us very clearly that those who speak in the gift of a tongue edify only themselves. They do nothing to help edify the church. So they, if there is no interpreter there, then the church will not be edified. So be quiet. Be quiet. And it's very clearly. So we can read through those scriptures and we can understand these things. And again, at the very end, Paul says, so brothers earnestly desire to prophesy, for that's the higher gift. And he says, and do not forbid speaking in tongues. Again, the rule of thumb that Paul just laid out is as long as there's interpreter. He says, but listen to this, and this is the last sentence. He says, but all things should be done decently and in order. Let's read that last line again, because it is very important. And many churches and many denominations lose this completely, completely miss 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 40. But all things should be done decently and in order. My friends, if you're chasing your visitors out of your church because they think you're crazy, then you are not furthering the gospel message of Yeshua HaMashiach, and you do not care, and that is not love for your brother. You're doing more damage than you are doing good, my friends. And again, I've explained this last week. I've seen this as sitting as an elder in a Pentecostal church for several years. I have seen this come to pass, my friends. People come in and there's people hollering and screaming and doing all of these times, and they turn right around, they walk out the door. Doesn't matter what the pastor has to say, doesn't matter what the gospel message is, because they're never going to have the opportunity to hear it. Because you did exactly the opposite of what Paul commands us concerning the gift of tongues in the church. And we are, and many denominational charters of men out there are mishandling this, and they are in direct opposition of what the scripture says concerning the true gift of tongues that some, not all, but some people have. So if we want to clearly understand the gift of tongues, we need to understand that what Paul has written concerning the gift of tongues to the church at Corinth. And everything that Paul has said up to this point in 1 Corinthians chapter 14 needs to be understood. And for more information on that, you can go back to last week's study that we did on Acts chapters 18 and 19, where we discussed this in detail. But just for the sake of any new viewers that we may have this week, I just want to make it clear that we've already discussed this topic. And for more information on the gift of tongues, according to the scriptures, you can visit us at holyimpactministries.com. Go to our Bible studies page and just look down through our studies on the book of Acts, and you will find last week's study entitled Acts chapter 18 and 19, Feasts and Tongues. So, with all of that being said, as we move into Acts chapter 19, part 2, it's important that we understand a few fundamental truths that are not often considered by today's modern-day professing Christians. And this week, I want to touch on the idea of which Jesus it is that we believe in, and which Jesus is it that we love and worship as our Messiah. Now, last week, we talked a little bit about Apollos, who we touched on in Acts chapter 19, at the end of 18, going into 19. And Apollos was from Alexandria, and it was said that he was a very, very eloquent speaker and a very educated man. He was highly educated, and he came teaching and preaching the word of the one true God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. But he had no idea who his Messiah was until Aquila and Priscilla took him aside and gave him the gospel message. And this brings to light a very important question that we must ask ourselves. Here was a man who had the word of God. He knew the Torah, he knew the Tanakh, he knew the writings of the prophets. But once again, with all of that knowledge and all of the different times that we have shown time and time and time again where our Messiah was prophesied about in the Torah and the Tanakh, the Old Testament. Still, with all of this wisdom, like so many other highly educated men, Apollos had missed his Messiah, who was there on earth at the same time he was. And once again, we've spoken several times about men who were highly educated, at least in their own eyes, who had come out of the synagogues and out of these colleges and these schools of divinity and schools of philosophy, and who were educated from birth concerning the things of the one true God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And many of them had even committed the first five books of Moses, the Pentateuch, to memory, and still could not see their own Messiah, who was right in front of them, until after his death, burial, and resurrection. Now, I say all of that to say this. I don't think it's a stretch by any means, my friends, to fully understand that if our Messiah was to return today the same way that he did back then, that hardly anyone would recognize him any more today than they did back then. Now, why do I say that? I say that because, once again, just like back then, we hold to what we've been taught by our churches, our synagogues, our colleges, our schools of philosophy, our early church fathers, rather than seeking the truth and the discernment that comes only from the Ruach HaKodesh of God, that leads us to all truth and reminds us of him according to our Messiah. And instead of reading the scriptures for ourselves, we trust in the wisdom of men. We trust in our prestigiously endowed pastors, priests, bishops, and popes, and our popish leaders, and our so-called early church fathers, just like they did back then. And we as modern-day Christians don't feel the need to study or even read the book for ourselves. It's just too easy to just rely on the man or the woman that's standing behind our pulpits, and we just expect that they know what they're talking about, without ever even testing the fruits of that man or that woman to see if their fruits be good or rotten. Once again, I want us to understand that what the Apostle Paul told the church at Corinth about worshiping what Paul called another Jesus. I want us to go back, and I just want us to touch on this one more time, and let's read 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 4 through 7, because this is tectonically important for us to see, to know, and to understand what is Paul talking about this other Jesus. And again, we can find that in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 4 through 7. So let's go check that out very quickly. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 4 through 7. Okay? He says this. He says, "For if someone comes and proclaims another Jesus," do we hear that? So obviously there is another Jesus according to Paul, is there not? Yes, indeed there is. He says, "For if someone comes preaching that other Jesus than the one we proclaimed, or if you receive a different spirit," hear this now, "a different spirit from the one you received, or if you accept a different gospel from the one you received, you put up with it readily enough." So what is he telling the church at Corinth here? He's telling them, he's saying, look, I've already given you these things. I've already taught you these things. And he says, now someone comes preaching another Jesus, another spirit, another gospel, and you're just putting up with it readily enough, he says. He continues, and he said, indeed, he says, "I consider that I am not in the least inferior to these super apostles." He says, "even if I am unskilled in speaking, I am not so in knowledge. Indeed, in every way we have made this plain to you in all things." He says, "or did I commit a sin in humbling myself so that you might be exalted, because I preached God's gospel to you free of charge?" I want us to hear this, my friends, and I want us to understand what Paul's talking about, this other Jesus. What is this other Jesus, this different spirit, this different gospel? My friends, it is a Jesus not found in the scripture anywhere. It is a Jesus who follows after the first day of the week, Catholic-created, man-made, man-fabricated Sunday Sabbath, rather than keeping the seventh-day holy, sanctified, commanded day of Yahuwah God, who said that it would be a sign between him and his people, a perpetual agreement for all generations forever. The seventh day, Sabbath, on the seventh day. You see, that's another Jesus. Another Jesus that celebrates the pagan birthday of every major sun god, from Tammuz to Horus to Osiris to Moloch, and on down the line throughout history on December 25th, calling it Christmas and his birthday. And we celebrate the divination and the magic of flying reindeer and magical elves and a fat man in a red suit that comes out of the fireplace to give our children all the desires of their desires, all the desires of their heart, as long as their name is written in his good book. My friends, that is another Jesus. That is another Jesus. Those people who worship our Messiah on Good Friday, when all four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, all tell us that he died on Preparation Day, which was the Passover. It was Passover Day in preparation for the Feast of Unleavened Bread. You see, that is another Jesus. It is another gospel, and I would submit to you, it is another spirit, the Christmas spirit. My friends, hear and heed the words of Paul, because this is tectonically important for us as Christians to know and to understand, and especially as we see him walking through Acts chapter 19 and the things that he is doing. And so it is, with this in mind, I want us to think about what Paul was saying in this scripture. Paul says that if someone comes and proclaims another Jesus than the one he and the apostles proclaimed, another Jesus other than we find in the scriptures, and if we receive another spirit, whether it be the Christmas spirit or the Easter spirit or whatever other spirit you might want to call upon, or if we accept a different gospel, again, Christmas, Good Friday, Easter, first day of the week, Sunday, Sabbath, none of which is found in the scripture anywhere. It's not in there, and you can't find it. And the reason you can't find it, again, my friends, is because it's not in there. It is another different gospel from the one that they accepted at the church at Corinth, and another gospel than the one we have been given in the scripture. And I want us to understand that. We put up with it readily enough. And so here's my question, my friends. When we read this scripture, is Paul simply talking to the church at Corinth, or is he talking to us? Is what Paul was speaking to the church at Corinth directly pointing to us as modern-day Christians today? Because I would submit to you that he is pointing directly at us in exactly the same way that he was speaking to the church at Corinth that very day. And I want us to think about that, and I want us to ponder this. Today we have over 5,000 different denominational charters of men out there, all teaching and all preaching another Jesus. And if it's true, as Paul says it is, that there is only one true Jesus and one true gospel, then is it too difficult for us to know and to understand that 4,400 and 9,900 of these different 5,000 denominations are wrong? Dead wrong. My friends, there is only one Messiah, one gospel. There is indeed only one true Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Messiah. And he is not found in the halls of Christian academia, my friends. Not any more than he was found in the halls of Judaism and the Jewish academia back in his time. The one true Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Messiah, is only found in our scriptures and in our scriptures alone, my friends, and nowhere else. And it doesn't matter how much money you amass from those who are lost, or how many monuments you erect, or how many megachurches you build, or how many Christian colleges that you construct, or how many learned philosophical professors you pack your Bible schools and seminaries with, my friends. There is indeed only one Jesus, one Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Messiah, and one gospel that he came to preach, which came from his Father. And if we don't read our scriptures for ourselves, we will be just as lost as both Paul and Apollos were before the gospel was made known to them. Paul goes on to say something very profound in his letter to the church at Galatia, and I want us to read Galatia chapter 1, verses 6 through 10. So let's go over and take a look at this, because I really want us to get an understanding of what Paul's ministry was all about. What was Paul teaching? What was Paul preaching in the book of Acts as he went from town to town? Let's check these things out. Let's know these things. Again, we want to go to Galatians, and I want to go to the first chapter, verses 6 through 10. And I want to read this very quickly. And here he is. And this is what he says. And I want us to hear this because this is very, very important. He says, once again, and remember what he just got done telling the church at Corinth. Well, let's hear what he says to the church at Galatia. He says this. He says, I'm astonished that you are so quickly deserting him who called you in the grace of the Messiah and are turning to a different gospel. Now, what did we just hear him tell the church at Corinth? Pretty much the same thing, wasn't it? Pretty much the same thing. Let's read that again. He says, I'm astonished that you are so quickly deserting him who called you in the grace of the Messiah and are turning to a different gospel. Not that there is one, says Paul, but there are some who trouble you and want to distort the gospel of the Messiah. Let's read that again. There are some who want to trouble you and who want to distort the gospel of the Messiah. Is there anybody around us like that today that want to trouble us and distort the gospel of the Messiah, do you suppose? He says, but even if we or an angel from heaven, even if we apostles or another angel from heaven should preach to you a gospel contrary to the one we preach to you in these scriptures, is what he's talking about, let him be accursed. Accursed, says Paul. As we have said, as we have said before, so I now say again. If anyone is preaching to you a gospel contrary to the one you received, let him be accursed. Which one did we receive, my friends? Which gospel did we receive? We received the gospel given to us in these scriptures from God himself. We did not receive the gospel from man, from any church father, from any denominational charter or club of men, from any seminary school or professor that might be teaching there. This is what Paul is talking about here. He says, even if we or an angel of heaven should preach to you a gospel contrary than the one we preached to you. Where's the gospel that Paul preached? Is the gospel that Paul preached found in seminary schools? No, it is not. Is it found by the great philosophy thinkers of Plato and Socrates and Aristotle? No, it is not. No, it is not. In fact, we are told clearly by our Messiah to call no man on our Father on earth, for we have one Father who is in heaven, and to call no man rabbi, before we are all brothers. We should know better than that. Paul's talking about the scriptures that he gave us in the scripture. That's what he's talking about, that gospel, that scripture. He says, for now am I seeking the approval of man or God? He says, for if I'm trying to please man, he says, am I trying to please man? He says, if I was still trying to please man, I would not be a servant of the Messiah. Powerful words here. that we are programmed as Christians to negate, to turn off, to turn away from, to just read over them quickly. That's not, he didn't really mean what he said there. Oh, yes, yes, he did. Yes. And men will try to get you to believe that what Paul is talking about here, the scriptures that he's talking about and the gospel that he's talking about, is their scripture and their gospel and their interpretation of it. Not so. Not so. Danger, danger, danger. Paul's talking about exactly what he said here and exactly the gospel and exactly that he preached here in these scriptures and not their interpretation of it. And you can't possibly understand this without the discernment that comes from his Ruach HaKodesh, his Holy Spirit, who he said would be the teacher. Our Messiah never said that a man would be a teacher. Our Messiah never tells us to go to a pastor, priest, bishop, or a pope for discernment. Not ever. In fact, he tells us to do the exact opposite he teaches. We are to come to him and test everything through the fire of prayer. And it is his Ruach HaKodesh that leads us to all truth and reminds us of the things that he has taught us. Nowhere does he say, I'm going to send you to a pope. I'm going to leave the vicar of Christ here so you can go to him. No, you won't find that in the scripture anywhere, my friends. Now, you will find it in church doctrine, and you will find it through the early church fathers, their so-called early church fathers, who we don't call church fathers because we are commanded not to call men our fathers here on earth, for we have one Father who is in heaven. That is a direct violation of the commandment of Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ himself. But all day long, that's all they want to talk about, is their early church fathers said this, and their early church fathers said that. Beware, my friends, beware. So we often think of the scriptures as not really having anything to do with us. We think that the scriptures that we read are all about another people. And that's the trap that we fall into. We think that they're for a people in another time, who were separate and apart from us. We think that they believed in something very different than what we believe in now today. We think that they're teaching things that are wrong, and our teachers are teaching things that are right. But I would submit to you, my friends, that it is we who are wrong. I would submit to you, my friends, that the people that we read about in our scripture are the same as we were. And although they may have lived in a different time and a different culture, humanity has not changed. And they are no different than we are today. And much of what they believed back then in their time is still what we believe in today. It's simply been repackaged and resold under the banner of modern-day contemporary Christendom. What we fail to realize as modern-day professing Christians is that the gospel message of Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ the Messiah, is not found in the New Testament alone. The gospel message of our Messiah is not found in the back half of the book only. It's not found in any one chapter, and it's not found in any one verse. The gospel message of our Messiah is the Bible, the 66 books of the Bible. The gospel message of our Messiah is that the love of God is that we obey and keep his commandments, and his commandments are not a burden to us. The gospel message of our Messiah is that he did not come to preach his own message, but his Father's message. The gospel message of our Messiah is that he did not come to abolish the law or the prophets. Not even the crossing of a T or the dotting of an I would pass from the law of his Father until heaven and earth pass away, and all things are accomplished. The gospel message of our Messiah, according to the Apostle Paul in Romans 3:31, is that we do not nullify the law by our faith, but rather that we uphold and establish the law. The gospel message of our Messiah is that according to Hebrews chapter 10, verses 26 through 27, if we go on sinning deliberately after receiving the knowledge of the truth, there no longer remains a sacrifice for sins, but a fearful expectation of judgment and the fury of fire that will consume the adversaries. This is the gospel message of our Messiah, and it is found all through the book, all 66 of them, in what we know as the Bible. And I would submit to you, my friends, that the gospel message of our Messiah is also found in Deuteronomy chapter 30, verses 11 through 14, where we're clearly told that the laws, the commandments, the precepts, and the appointments of our Father are not too hard for us, neither is it far off. But the very word of God our Father is near us, and it is in our mouths, and it is in our hearts so that we can do them. But you see, that's not what their Jesus is all about. Their Jesus is all about, do as thou wilt is the whole of the law. That's their lifestyle. That's their motto. Dispensational grace. Once saved, always saved. Pre-tribulation rescue for everyone. No persecution here to see, my friends. Everyone is encouraged to go ahead and scream out in tongues and jump all over the place and roll on the floors and scare as many people away from the gospel message of Yeshua as you possibly can. Instead of letting all things be done decently and in order, as the Apostle Paul himself clearly instructed us in 1 Corinthians 14:40. So the bottom line, my friends, is which Jesus do we follow? The one true Jesus found only in the Scripture and made known only through the Ruach HaKodesh, who our Messiah says leads us to all truth? Or the man-made, man-created, man-fabricated Jesus that the God of this world has created for us to follow after? This, my friends, is something that every single professing Christian should ponder in their own hearts. But the problem for so many of us is that we cannot ponder what we cannot even see. Moving forward, I want us to talk about the parting of ways that we see in Acts chapter 19. As we move forward, we also see something very extraordinary in verses 8 through 10. Let's go back and let's visit Acts chapter 19. We want to visit verses 8 through 10. So let's go check that out very quickly. Acts chapter 19, 8 through 10. And let's read this together. It says this: And he entered the synagogue, and for 3 months spoke boldly, reasoning and persuading them about the kingdom of God. But when some became stubborn and continued in unbelief, speaking evil of the way before the congregation, he withdrew them and took the disciples with him, reasoning daily in the hall of Tyrannus. This continued for 2 years, so that all the residents of Asia heard the word of the Lord, both Jews and Greeks. Now, what we're seeing here is a split in the church. We're told that Paul takes the believing Jews away from the synagogue and starts his own teaching in the hall of Tyrannus. Now, this is one of the first times that we see Paul actually taking people out of the synagogue and to begin teaching them separately and apart from the synagogue. Now, notice that it says in verse 9 that some of the Jews were speaking evil of the way. And so it's pretty clear that this is why Paul decided to break them into two different groups and to take the believers away from those who did not believe. It should be clear to us that this is an unusual move for the Apostle Paul. It should be clear that Paul in no way wanted to separate the Jew from the Gentile, nor did he want to create his own church, nor did he intend on causing either group to hate each other. It had always been Paul's intention to keep all believers in the Jewish synagogues all together under one banner of the one true God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. But when the Jews, who had been programmed by the Pharisees in their man-made oral laws, also known as the Halakha, started to treat the true believers with contempt, Paul knew that he had to separate them so that those who did believe would not be mixing with unbelievers. Paul, who was a pastor, which means a shepherd, was simply protecting the sheep from the wolves. He knew that the sheep and the wolves did not mix any more than oil and water mix. And Paul knew that if he had tried to keep them together, there'd be nothing but chaos, and this was no way for a shepherd to protect his flock. And so Paul did what any good shepherd would do. He separated the believing sheep from the non-believing wolves. Once again, I would submit to you, my friends, that this is exactly where many of us are at. So many email us each and every month wanting to know where they can go to worship with true believers that are not interested in keeping the rituals and the traditions, the holidays, the myths of men, but want to know where they can go to worship with fellowship, like those who believe like they do, those who are only interested in doing what the Scripture says, and not what men have fabricated. Many who begin to read the Scriptures for themselves and hear the truth of the gospel message for the first time want to know if they should leave the church that they're in, because they know that the church is not teaching and preaching what's found in the Scripture. And they don't want their children to be indoctrinated with the wisdom of men, but rather the truth of God's written word. And for many of us who have had to leave these kinds of churches, it can be a very grueling ordeal, to say the least. To leave a church that you've been going to for any length of time can be a gut-wrenching experience, my friends. And to say that it's uncomfortable is to say the least. This doesn't even give anyone the full effect of what many of us have gone through in order to worship the one true God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob correctly, the way that He wants to be worshiped. Many of us have lost many friends. Many of us have lost family, lifelong acquaintances. Some of us have had to even walk away from prestigious positions from within our own communities and within our own churches. I know of senior pastors that have had to walk away from sizable churches and large congregations of people, not because they wanted to, but because their denominational charter of men that they belong to forced them out among their ranks. Once again, because they began to preach the truth of God's word according to God's word and not according to theirs. Paul knew the importance of separation, and he knew how important it was to set the evil man outside of the church. And we should make no mistake about it, my friends. If the church we attend is not teaching the truth of God's word according to God's word, and if they are worshiping another Jesus and teaching another Jesus and another gospel, we need not be unequally yoked together with them. For this is not the will of God the Father, according to the Scripture. If anyone is clearly teaching another Jesus and another gospel message, then that person or that congregation or church is accursed according to the Apostle Paul. They are accursed. And we just read that in Galatians chapter 1, verse 8. And if they refuse the truth of God's word as written in God's word, then they are unbelievers because they do not believe in the truth of God's word as written in God's word. And we're clearly told in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 14 through 17, that we are not to be yoked together with unbelievers, and that we are to come out of their midst and be separate from them. Paul was simply practicing what he was preaching when he separated the synagogue and he took the believers out from the midst of the unbelievers. You see, Paul was not someone who just preached one thing and then turned around and did another. Paul stood firmly on the word of God at every single solitary turn, and Paul always practiced what he preached. And once again, for those who may be new and just tuning in with us here today, Paul himself always lived in obedience to the law. Not according to us, not according to any church fathers, not according to any philosophical think tank, But according to James, the brother of our Messiah and the Jerusalem Council, and you can go ahead and you can read that in Acts chapter 21, verse 24, if you've never read that before. So with all of that being said, it's again very important to understand that Paul did not come in and separate all the synagogues and create new Christian churches all over the landscape, my friends. Paul only separated those who had to be separated. It's important for us to understand that Christianity, as we now know it today, that seems to be some kind of separate and distinct religious institution that's led by Gentiles, was not even born until sometime after the late 90s AD. So what we need to understand is that the followers of Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ the Messiah, were known as the Way. They weren't known as Christians. They were known as the Way, and they were still being led by Jews, and they were still mostly meeting in Jewish synagogues, not in so-called separate Christian churches with steeples and pews and organs and all of those types of things, that we stained glass windows and things that we see today. They were always perceived, even within Judaism, as a sect of Judaism. The outside world of paganism even made no distinction between those who were followers of the Way and those who were part of Judaism. They were always perceived as one sect, one religion, much like the Sadducees and the Pharisees. They believed different things, but all claimed to serve the one true God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And so it was with those who we would think were Christians today, also known as the followers of the Way, and the Jews. They were the same. They were grafted into the same olive tree, and we can read that in Romans chapter 11. It's very clear. Again, we can read that in Galatians as well, and all throughout the Word of God. From the very beginning, Numbers 15:15, Exodus. But then, when the Gentiles saw a follower of Yeshua Jesus, and they saw him walking down the street next to a Jew, back then, the pagans couldn't tell a Jew away the difference from someone who believed in the Messiah. They couldn't tell them apart. They both looked exactly the same. They were both following exactly the same laws. They both dressed the same. They looked the same. They worshiped the same. And most of the time, they worshiped even in the same place, in the synagogues. For all intents and purposes, they believed much of the same thing. The only difference between them was that some believed in Yeshua Jesus as the Jewish Messiah, and some did not. But both believed in the Torah and the Tanakh and the writings of the prophets, and both served the same one true God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. The same law that applied in what we now know as the Old Testament is the same law that applies today in what we now know as the New Testament. Take into consideration what John tells us in the biblical definition of what the biblical definition of sin is in the New Testament. And let's go read that. It's 1 John 3:4. Let's go read 1 John 3:4 very quickly. What is the definition of the law in the New Testament? It says this. John says, everyone who makes a practice of sinning also practices lawlessness. Sin is lawlessness. Now, if we turn to the King James Version of the Bible, I like the way that they say it best. We're going to go to the same verse in the King James Version. They just word it a little differently. Let's look at it. It says, whoever committeth sin transgresseth also the law, for sin is the transgression of the law. Is that what sin was in the Old Testament? The transgression of the law? Yeah. Is sin still what sin is in the New Testament? The transgression of the law, according to John? Yeah. I want us to see that, and I want us to understand these things. Lawlessness is another way of saying lawbreaker. Someone who breaks the law of God, or someone who is lawless, is someone who is without God's law. And sin itself cannot even exist without the law, because sin itself is, according to the Scripture, the transgression of the law, according to John in the Scripture. Not according to some philosophical think tank, or some early church father, or some denominational charter of men, but according to the Scripture, That's what sin is. The biblical definition of sin is the transgression of the law, my friends. Not the law of men, not the law of the Pope, not the law of Rome, the law of God. I want us to understand that, my friends. It's not the law of Mormonism or Hinduism or any other law. It is the law of the one true God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob that can only be found in the Torah and the Tanakh and the writing of the prophets in your Old Testament. So it should be clear that the New Testament definition of sin is the same as the Old Testament definition of sin. There is no difference between the two. The only distinction that can be made between the two is that our Messiah, Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, paid the penalty for breaking the law for those of us who have faith and believe in Him. Once again, nowhere in your Bible, nowhere in the 66 books of the Bible, will you ever read that Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, abolished or did away with the law. It simply tells us that He did away with the penalty of the law, or also known as the curse of the law, but not the law itself. And in fact, if we were to take any time at all studying the book of Matthew in chapter 5, verses 17 through 20, we would know better than that. In fact, I would submit to you, my friends, that if you read Matthew chapter 5, verses 5 through 17, without any preconceived denominational programming, you would clearly be able to see that our Messiah, just as He states, did not come to abolish the law or the prophets, and that not even the dotting of an I or the crossing of a T would pass from His Father's law until heaven and earth pass away and all things are accomplished. And once again, my friends, that does not happen until Revelation chapter 21. But you see, my friends, we read that scripture with our doctrinal biases in mind. And we don't see it for what it says because we've been taught and programmed other things by our different denominational charters of men. And so when we read that scripture now, we don't read it as children coming to the truth. We read it as we've been programmed to read it. And this is nothing more than a trap that has been set by our adversary. But we can't see it because the booby trap has been camouflaged with our preconceived, pre-programmed, denominational training and understanding. You see, if you're standing in the dark and you're wearing sunglasses, you're not going to be able to see anything, period. The only thing that you're going to be able to even think that you see is what someone tells you or what someone programs you to see through suggesting things to you and through whispering them in your ear. But when God takes off those sunglasses, even though you're still standing in the dark, your eyes can then adjust to the darkness so that you can at least see the outline of the truth. And before long, before you realize what's going on, what has been suggested to you, when you actually have a chance to see it, you understand that what has been whispered in your ears by men is not at all what's standing right before you. And before you know it, you're not standing in the dark any longer. And God has removed the darkness from you and brought you into His marvelous light. And this, my friends, is how it happens. When we follow after the wisdom of men, we follow after the darkness of men. We put on the sunglasses and walk right into the darkness. But when we choose the light of truth found only in the Scriptures and through our Father's Ruach HaKodesh, this is when we begin to walk in the light and to properly follow after the one true Messiah, the one true Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, who is the only life, the only truth, and the only way. For more information on sin, you might want to tune in this Saturday morning for our Seventh-day Sabbath broadcast when we'll be studying what the Scripture says about willful and intentional sin and whether or not that is forgiven according to the Scripture and what the Scripture says about those who sin willfully and intentionally. And I think you'll be surprised to hear and to understand what it was that our Messiah came to lay down his life for, and what he did not come to lay down his life for. With that being said, let's go ahead and move on here in Acts chapter 19, and I want to talk a little bit about the magic cloth of Paul. Moving into verses 11 and 12, we see something even more perplexing concerning the miracles that Paul was doing. So let's go back, and I want to read Acts chapter 19, and we're going to look at verses 11 and 12. So let's go ahead and take a look at that very quickly here. Acts chapter 19, verses, and we're going to go to 11 and 12. Let me get back there very quickly here in the green, and we're just going to read what's in the green section here. It says this, "And God was doing extraordinary miracles by the hands of Paul, so that even handkerchiefs or aprons that touched his skin were carried away to the sick, and their diseases left them, and the evil spirits came out of them." Very powerful. Very powerful scripture right here. So what are we to make of this handkerchief that touches Paul's skin? And what would then have the power of healing? Was it Paul that healed those who were healed by this handkerchief of his? Or was it God? Clearly, my friends, it indeed was our Father, God, Yahuwah. Paul by himself didn't have any power to do such things. I want us to read John chapter 15, verses 4 through 6, just to be clear on this biblical fact. So again, I want to take us over very quickly. We want to read John. We're going to go to chapter 14 very quickly here. And we're going to go to verses 4 through 6. And let's read this. Again, red letter words comes from the book of John. He says this, Yeshua says, "Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit by itself, unless it abides in the vine, neither can you, unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever abides in me, and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit." Listen to what he says now. "For apart from me, you can do nothing." So again, Paul not having the power to do these things on his own. Where did that power come from? Came from Messiah Yeshua and his Father. He says very clearly, he says, "For apart from me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not abide in me, he is thrown away like a branch and withers. And the branches are gathered, thrown into the fire, and burned." I want us to understand these things, and I want us to understand this. It wasn't Paul, just because it was touching his skin and Paul happened to be somebody. No, it was the power of Yahuwah God through the Son, Yeshua HaMashiach, that this cloth, this inanimate object, was able to heal and even chase out demons. And so with that being said, it should be very clear to us that it was not Paul himself that was able to heal people and to cast out demons, but rather the Father and the Son who were in him that had the power to do such things. And I just want to be very clear on that. Something else becomes very clear as we read through the scriptures. And that is that it should be understood that inanimate objects can also be used by God to hold certain powers according to the scripture. What we're seeing here in Acts chapter 19 with this handkerchief and this this tablecloth or whatever it was there is nothing new for those of us who are familiar with the rest of the 66 books of the Bible. Remember, the woman who had hemorrhaged for 12 years, who had had enough faith to touch the tzitzits, the tassels on the Messiah's robe. The woman was healed in Matthew chapter 9, verses 20 through 22. And remember the staff of Aaron that became the snake and ate the other two snakes of Pharaoh's sorcerers in Exodus chapter 7, verses 10 through 12. And several other places where certain inanimate objects were used to show the power of the one true God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And we won't even get into the Ark of the Covenant and the power it had, my friends. So, once again, these inanimate objects had nothing to do with the power that came with them any more than the men who held them. It was simply God working through these objects that gave them the power that they had. And they were always used to give witness to the power of the glory of the one true God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Very important to understand this. Now, with that in mind, say all that to say this, we're now going to get into exorcising people and demons and all of this kind of thing. Let's get into that. Moving forward, we see something even more astounding in verse 13, okay, and 17. So let's read this most peculiar scripture in Acts chapter 19, verses 13 through 17. And again, this is very, very unsettling here. So let's go check this out about these demons here very quickly. And again, we're going to read what's in the yellow down here at the bottom, Acts chapter 19. We're going to start with verse 13. It says, then some of the itinerant Jewish exorcists undertook to invoke the name of the Lord Jesus over those who had evil spirits, saying, I adjure you by the name of Jesus, whom Paul proclaims. Seven sons of a Jewish high priest named Sceva were doing this. But the evil spirit answered them, and listen to what he says. The evil spirit says, Jesus I know, Paul I recognize, but who are you? And the man in whom was the evil spirit leapt on them, mastered all of them, and overpowered them, so that they fled out of the house naked and wounded. And this became known to all the residents of Ephesus, both Jews and Greeks, and fear fell upon them all. And the name of the Lord Yeshua was extolled. Interesting scripture, a lot to be seen here. Of course, when the people saw that even Paul's handkerchief could heal people and cast out demons, some of these Jewish exorcists decided to try and to use the name of Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, to try and exorcise these demons out of this person. But they wound up getting a rather rude awakening, and the evil spirit, their spirit looks at them and he says, Jesus I know and Paul I recognize, but who are you? And then he proceeds to strip them of their clothes, and he proceeds to give them the business end of the boot. My friends, very interesting scripture. Now this, my friends, should be a lesson. I just want to say this. Should be a lesson for all of us to learn. You cannot just walk around throwing the name of Jesus around like some kind of token piece, my friends. And even in today's culture, we see these so-called healers using the name of Jesus on television and the internet to try and trick people into following after them, claiming that they can exorcise demons and to do all kinds of healing miracles. But what does the scripture say? What does the scripture say? Let's turn to 1 John chapter 2, verses 3 through 6. Very quickly, I want to turn there. And we're going to go back here very quickly. Let me grab this up, 1 John, and we're going to go chapter 2, verses 3 through 6. Listen to this now. It says, and by this we know that we've come to know him. Okay? You have to know Yahweh God in order to use the name of his son. And what does it say here? This is how we know that we've come to know him. If we keep his commandments. If we keep his commandments. You see, this salvation that is given is not a do as thou wilt is the whole of the law type of religion, my friends. Not at all. Not a once saved, always saved religion, as we have been told over and over and over again by those who need to spend more time reading their Bibles than they do teaching and preaching. By this we may know that we have come to know him if we keep his commandments. Now listen to this in John 2:4. For whoever says, I know him, but does not keep his commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But whoever keeps his word, in other words, obeys his commandments, in him truly the love of God is perfected. By this we may know that we are in him. Whoever says, and hear this now, 1 John 2:6, whoever says that he abides in him ought to walk in the same way in which he walked. Is that too hard for us to understand? We would do well to remember this scripture, my friends. If that man on that TV or on that internet or on that stage or in that amphitheater or in that mega church is not keeping the commandments of Yahweh God as written in the scripture, then the scripture tells us that he is a liar and that the truth is not in him. And if the truth is not in him, then he has no real power. At least not the power of the one true God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Now, getting back to the staff of Aaron in Exodus chapter 7, verses 10 through 12. Let's read that for just a moment, because I want to make another point here before we leave this. Again, we're going to go back to Exodus chapter 7 very quickly here, and we're going to take a look at verses 10 through 12. Let's read this. It says, "So Moses and Aaron went to Pharaoh and did just as Yahovah commanded. Aaron cast down his staff before Pharaoh and his servants, and it became a serpent. Then Pharaoh summoned the wise men and the sorcerers, and they, the magicians of Egypt, also did the same in their secret arts. For each man cast down his staff, and they became serpents. But Aaron's staff swallowed up their staffs." Okay. Now, what do we see here? And I want us to notice this. We see that the sorcerers of Pharaoh also had powers to turn their staffs into snakes, didn't they? Yes, they did have some power, didn't they? But what happened to God's, what happened? God's serpent ate the serpents of Pharaoh's, didn't it? So what does that tell us? It should tell us that our adversary is always trying to imitate the things of Yahovah God, our Father. He's always trying to imitate him. But what he imitates is simply an imitation. The true power of the one true God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob cannot be matched by any man, angel, devil, or demon. And it's important to realize these things, because we're told that in the last days, this Antichrist, this man of perdition, will also do many miracles and will even be able to call down fire out of heaven to trick and fool, if it were possible, even the very elect. So these demons of our adversary do have what we would call some supernatural powers that they can use to try and trick us if we're not aware of these things. But the power that they have does not, and I repeat, does not supersede the power of the one true God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And this is why, my friends, it's so important to test the spirits. Let's go ahead and let's read John chapter 4, verses 1 through 6. Very quickly, I want to read 1 John chapter 4. Let me bounce down there very quickly here. 1 John chapter 4, and we want to go 1 through 6. And let's just read this. It says, "Beloved, do not believe every spirit." Let's read that again. "Beloved, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they are from God. For many false prophets have gone out into the world." This is a warning for us. "By this you know the spirit of God." Okay, this is how you can test the spirits, in other words. "Every spirit that confesses that Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, has come in the flesh is from God. Every spirit that does not confess Yeshua is not from God. This is the spirit of the Antichrist, which you heard was coming and now is in the world already. Little children, you are from God and have overcome them. For he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. They are from the world, therefore they speak from the world, and the world listens to them. We are from God. Whoever knows God listens to us. Whoever is not from God does not listen to us. By this we know the spirit of truth and the spirit of error." I want us to know that, and we should highlight this in our Bibles so that we have this highlighted. The Jewish exorcist that we see in Acts chapter 19, the sons of Sceva, in verse 13, were using the name of Yeshua, Jesus, but had no real faith in Jesus. And this evil spirit knew it. He was well aware of it. They did not belong to the vine. They were not part of the olive tree. They had not been grafted in. And they were not covered by the blood of Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Messiah. And so it was that this evil spirit and these spirits that were in this person had nothing to fear of these so-called Jewish exorcists. And he knew it. They were not obeying and keeping the commandments of the one true God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And they certainly had no idea who their Messiah even was. And here they are now playing with fire using the name of Jesus. and they just happened to have gotten burned. My friends, watch out for these internet exorcists and these wolves in sheep's clothing that claim to be able to cast out demons. If they themselves are not keeping the commandments of the one true God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, then according to the one true God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, they are liars and the truth is not in them. They are nothing more than cheap magicians, and many of them are not worshiping the God that you think that they are worshiping, my friends. The scriptures that we see here were given to us to keep us safe, to keep us away from these kinds of people, if we would only read them for ourselves. And with that, my friends, we will close this portion of our study on the book of Acts chapter 19. Once again, I want to thank you so very, very much for joining me here today. It is always a pleasure to meet with you. And again, I apologize for not being able to do this particular study live with the chat rooms open because of the failure of our internet. But at least we have this particular study out there. And again, it can be downloaded. It's free. You can watch it at your own leisure. It will be in the archives along with the PDF file that we have here. So everything we have spoken about will be in that PDF file. You can take these scriptures, test them, cut them, copy them, paste them, and use them for your own Bible studies. And that's what we want you to do, my friends. Very, very important to know and understand these things. Be ready. Have hard copies of this stuff. When all of these electronic devices go down and there is nothing else here, we can't get in our computers and our tablets and our iPhones and iPads and all that to open up, we want to make sure we have hard copies of our studies so that we can know and understand these things and teach these things. Because, my friends, it's when the lights go out and it's when all of these things go away that people will be looking for the man and the woman of God. And you can bet on that, my friends. So, with all of that being said, God bless you. And once again, my hope and my prayer is that the face of Yahuwah God, in the name of Yeshua HaMashiach, would shine upon you and your family until we meet again. I pray that his hand of protection would be upon you. And I pray that the discernment and the endurance that only comes from his Ruach HaKodesh, he would give to you in the name of Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, I pray over you. Again, thank you so very much for your patience with us here today, and thank you for allowing me to pre-record this for you and to have this out for you. Again, visit us at holyimpactministries.com, and we'll see you this Seventh-day Sabbath, 9 a.m. Eastern Standard Time, to talk about willful and intentional sin. Is it forgiven? God bless, and shalom. Our song, we lift our voice, we raise our arms. The voice of the Lord over waters, the voice of the Lord shakes the desert, the voice of time.